like to welcome everybody out tonight. Hey, good to see you back out. It's worship the Lord tonight. Excited to hear Brother Ryan here in just a little while. Y'all be praying for him as he comes. And looking forward to that. He's got 2 gallons of water up here, so I don't know how long he... Just 1 gallon. He preaches enough to drink all that. We'll be here a while. So, but anyways, y'all... y'all be... May have to. So y'all be praying for him. Excited about that. Do got a couple prayer requests tonight. Brother Ryan texted me right after service this morning and said that he has got another kidney stone. He just got over one. So, and he's leaving. He's driving a van tomorrow for the youth for the Arise conference. So y'all pray for him tonight that he feels better. He still had his medicine, he said, from the last one he had. So y'all pray for him, and maybe that thing will pass pretty soon. So, and then we've got a couple folks not here tonight. Brother Josh had to go help at another church tonight that was having an issue. So that's all I've got. Any other announcements before we move forward? Remember her for sure. Another one to spoil. I'm praying for Tiffany. She goes. Everything goes smooth. All right. Also, don't forget, after service is dismissed tonight, we will be having conference, so don't forget about that. All right. If you love Jesus, say amen.
Amen.
It's good to see each of you back again tonight, like I said, and just excited to worship with you tonight. I'm going to ask Brother Darrell Akins if he'll take us to the Lord in prayer. And then turn it over to Brother Jason.
Most holy and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessing of another opportunity and the ability to gather here in your house to hear your word preached. Father God, I ask you to free us from distractions of ourselves in this world. Speak to us and help us to hear. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
Somebody grab your book and stand up. Y'all are stuck with me and David tonight as your musicians. Everybody sing really loud. Page 479, Father.
for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. He loves us so. Portion and here's our prize, drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If faith was an ocean, we're all sinking. So heaven meets earth like an unseen kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh,
amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost. like a race appear. The air I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has reigned. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Good evening, everybody. Thank all y'all for coming out tonight. Thank Brother Nick and all the deacons for giving me another opportunity to be here and to be able to preach. I'm going to go ahead and get started. We're going to be in Psalm 51. So if you will, when you get there, please stand. And I wonder if there's anybody here tonight might have a word or a testimony, anything that I want to say before we get started. All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. We're going to be in, like I said, Psalm 51, starting in verse 1. The Bible says, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness. According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear with that when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." Verse 6, "Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O Lord, or O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this day, Lord. I want to thank you for all the many blessings you've given us, Lord. I want to thank you for giving us another opportunity to come out here tonight, Lord, and be able to worship with you, Lord. Lord, I pray that you just be with us tonight. I pray that you just sit with us like a fog, Lord. I pray that you just, that we would just abide with you, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would help us throughout this week, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would just place your hand on this service tonight, Lord, that you would just let your will be done in it, Lord. Lord, I pray that we would apply this message to our lives, Lord, so that we're not just living for you on Sunday morning, but we're living for you for the rest of the week, Lord. Lord, I pray that you just watch over us and keep us safe. In Jesus' name I do pray. Amen.
Amen.
A little background on the scripture right here is David is writing this psalm after he has messed up. Most of us know the story of David and Bathsheba, where David had seen Bathsheba showering on a rooftop, and he liked what he saw, and he tried to get her to come to him. So he got some of his people to come to go get Bathsheba, brought him over to his little palace area, and then so on and so forth. After that, he goes into to hide up his sin, try to hide his sin. He gets Bathsheba's husband killed. And here we get to where Nathan the prophet has confronted him about this, kind of like how Nick was talking about last week with an accountability partner. Nathan is that accountability partner for him, because I'm sure Nathan didn't really want to do that, because he's got to go up to his king and say, hey, you messed up. And it's different from when it's just your friend or something like that, but he's going up to the king right now. And so Nathan here, he's being that accountability partner that Nick talked about last week, and he's told David, he says, you shouldn't have done this. This was not right. And this is where David's at right now. He's writing this psalm as he's writing to God in this psalm right here. And the first thing I see here is that David's acknowledging that he's messed up.
Amen. Amen.
The first three verses, it says, have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. He goes to God and he tells him, he's like, God, I've messed up. And God already knew that he had messed up. But in order for him to grow and in order for him to fix what he has done, he has to go to God.
Amen.
He has to go to God and say, God, I know I've messed up. I know I've done this, but please forgive me. And in verse 4, he says, against thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. In verse 4, he's showing us and himself that when you sin, although others are affected by your sin in your life, the ultimate thing is you have wronged God. You have sinned against God. And you have to go to God, and you have to ask God for forgiveness, because you can ask people here on earth for forgiveness, but that don't mean anything if you ain't got forgiveness from God. And the second thing I see here is starting in verse 7, where he's asking God for his forgiveness. It says, purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. David can feel there's a separation from him and God.
Amen.
Because there's that sin in his life that he has unforgiven sin because he didn't ask for forgiveness yet. And he has that sin is creating a wall or a barrier between him and God. And he can't have that relationship with God that he needs to have if he has that unforgiven sin in his life.
Amen. Right.
And in verse 10 through 12, it says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. It says that, cast me not away from thy presence. And this ain't saying that God's going to throw you away from his presence. When you're in your walk with God, he's not going to throw you out. This is saying that when you sin, when you mess up in your life, there's going to be a separation from you and God. Because your sin is a rebellion from God, and you can't be living in sin and living with God at the same time.
Amen.
You're either serving God or you're serving the devil. You can't work for both sides, and you can't be neutral.
Amen.
Because you're either working for God or you're working against God. And in verse 12, where it says, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, David's not losing. You can't lose your salvation. But what it's saying here is that you can lose the joy that you have in your salvation from having that sin in your life. You can lose the joy from your salvation from having that unforgiven sin in your life, or having that sin that you just keep on messing up in. If you just keep on with that, it'll cause separation from you and God, and it'll cause you to lose that joy in your salvation. Because if you're living for God and you're trying your best and you're doing what God has called you to do, then you have a joy in your life that no matter what's going on in your life, you're going to be able to make it through that. You know that God's going to be there. You know that God is going to take care of you. Because we know that for all those that love God, all things will work out.
Amen.
As long as you're in God's will, things will work out for the good. And at this point, David has got to where he has realized that the impact of the sin that he has committed, he's realized the impact that's had on his life. Not more so a physical effect, but an emotional and spiritual effect. It's caused him to grow distant from God. It's caused him to separate from God. And in verse 10, he talks about how his spirit ain't right. It says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. He can feel in his heart that he is not where he needs to be with God.
Amen.
He can feel in his heart that there's darkness in it. He says, create me a clean heart. He's trying. He wants to get rid of the sin in his life so that he can get back to where he was with God and hopefully get further along in his relationship with him. And that gets on into some of the other effects of sin, where we have spiritual separation from God because of the sin in our life, where it creates a barrier between us and God. And when you sin, each time you sin, it becomes easier and easier and easier to sin. Just like with anything that you do, when you sin, it's easier to sin the next time. And when you continuously sin, you keep on messing up and you keep on messing up, you can't achieve the purpose that God has for you.
Amen.
You can't achieve the purpose that God has for you because you can only go so far. You can grow in your relationship with God if you have sin in your life, but you can only go so far. Because you get to a point where if you're not willing to give up this, then why would God put more over you or give you more responsibility if you're not willing to get rid of this sin in your life? And like I said, you can't achieve God's purpose for you if you have this sin in your life, because he's trying to use you, but you're not allowing him to. Because he says, I will use you if you'll take this sin out. But if you don't take that sin out of your life, you're going to end up stuck in a rut. You're going to be sitting there trying to grow in a relationship when you've got a wall in between you and God. And your sin don't just affect you. Just like all actions in your life, sin affects the people around you.
Amen.
It affects all the people around us. And Just like if you was to do good, that would affect the people around you. If you do bad, it affects the people around you. And sometimes we seem like, we feel like the bad affects more than the good sometimes. And in a way that it'll affect people around you, if you're living a certain way, if you're living like the world, you're not setting the example that you need to set.
Amen.
If you're living just like everybody else is, you're going, you go to church on Sunday and you profess that you're a Christian, you say you live for God, and you say all these things on Sunday, you stand up, you sing at church, you do all these other things, maybe you'll do the prayer after class or something like that, maybe you even teach a Sunday school. But if you're just living for God on Sunday morning or Sunday night or Wednesday, and you're not living for God the rest of the week, then you are not setting the example that you need to set.
Amen.
Because if you get up there, you say, I'm a Christian, I do all these things, I'm a Sunday school teacher, and then you get out and you do all these other things that all the other people do it that you see, and people that see you, they see you do all these other things, they say, well, if he can do that, then why can't I? Or maybe they'll see, why would I want a relationship with God if it's the same thing that I've already got? There's nothing new about what they've got other than that they say that they're different. But I don't see a difference in them. And a lot of times that's the big problem with the church today. Not just this church, but the church as a whole. That's the big problem with the church today, is that we're not setting the example that we need to set.
Amen.
We got people that come into the church and they see us, and maybe they're just visiting the church, but they've seen us out partying before. And that puts a bad light on the church, and that puts a bad light on God. When if we was to live right, then there'd be, if we was to set the example the way we need to, all of our churches would be filled up.
Amen.
Because then they would realize that what the Bible is saying is actually true. Because if we have people, more and more people living it out, then we have all these other people that, if we have more and more people living it out, then there's more and more people that's going to want to come into it.
Amen.
And the influence you have over people, all of us have influence. You may not think it's a lot, but all of us have influence, and that's, influence is one of the biggest things in Christianity and in our walk with God, because when we set our example, when we set the example, we're influencing everybody around us.
Amen.
And you may think, well, I'm not very popular. I don't talk to very many people, or I'm not around a lot of people at work or anywhere. Well, I'm going to tell you about one of the most unlikely influential people in the Bible. In John 4, it talks about the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well. And most of us know the story of where Jesus said, I must go to Samaria. And he goes to this area, and he sits at this well while he waits for his disciples to go and to get food from the town or whatever they're doing. And he sits there. And there's a woman that comes around the sixth hour of the day, and that's very unusual because it's the hottest time of the day, and most time all the women, they come at the same time so they can do it together and all this. Well, this woman, she's by herself. She's by herself, and she don't have anybody with her. And Jesus asks her, says, "Can you give me a drink?" And the woman looks at him, and she says. Why would I give you a drink? Why would you want me to give you a drink? I'm a Samaritan and you're a Jew. And Samaritans and Jews at that time, they did not get along. Jews thought Samaritans were unclean. And he asked her, he says, "Would you give me a drink?" And she says, "Why would you want me to do that?" And he says, "If you only knew who I was, you'd be asking me for water." Because Whoever drinks of the water I give them will never thirst again, but whoever drinks from this water will thirst again. She says, well, give me some of this drink. Well, he says, bring me your husband. And she says, I don't have a husband. And Jesus tells her, like, you're right to say you don't have a husband because you have had five husbands. And the one you're living with now is not your husband. And she, rightfully so, gets confused. And not understanding how he knows that. And then she says, we've heard of a man called Christ that has come to save us. And Jesus says, I am he. And it goes on further into it where it talks about how she had gone off into the village saying that, come see a man that told me everything I ever did. He must be the Messiah. And in chapter 4 of John, verse 39, it says, and many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the saying of the woman which testified, he told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans were come unto him, they besought him that he would tarry with them. And he abode there 2 days, and many more believed because of his own word. And he said unto the woman, now we believe, not because of thy saying, for we have heard him ourselves, and know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. A woman that was an outcast, a woman that was shunned and thought it was very shameful and had what most people would say had no influence because no one really talked to her, because of the willingness to go out and tell people about Christ, many in the city learned about Christ.
Amen.
Many in the city come to the knowledge of Christ just because of the willingness that she had to go and tell everybody about him. No matter how unlike she was, or no matter how much people thought she was unclean or whatever they had thought, she put that all aside and said that, I met Christ and I want to show you him too. And if we would just do that, if we would just be like the Samaritan woman, if we would use the influence that we have, and a lot of us, we probably have more influence than that woman did right there, because she wasn't liked by the whole entire town. And you see where people had come to Christ just because of her willingness to go and tell everybody. And if we would use the influence that we have and set aside the sin in our life, we would ask God for forgiveness and push that sin away so we could let God use us. Just imagine the things that God could do in our life.
Amen.
If we would push away the sin in our life, if we would push away all that so we're no longer spiritually separated from God, so that we could forever abide with God. Instead of being stuck in this lifetime, because this lifetime's not that long compared to eternity. It's not long at all. But we're too busy worried about being comfortable in this lifetime. We're too busy worried about being happy and worrying about what we're gonna do this week and what we're gonna do for us right now, instead of worrying about what we can do for God right now.
Amen.
We're too worried about the here and now, instead of worried about the people that are lost and going to hell right now. The sin in our life affects everyone around us. And it can cause long-lasting consequences too. One mistake could ruin your whole entire testimony. One mistake, one thing that you do in your life could ruin your whole entire testimony. Maybe not for everybody, but if you do something out with some friends and they see you doing things that you shouldn't do, you have likely ruined your testimony for them. Maybe you still have influence over all these other people, but maybe that was the person, maybe you was the person to get that one individual to Christ.
Amen.
Because I believe that There are certain people in our lives that only we can reach through God. And if we aren't living our lives the way we need to, if we're not doing what God calls us to do, if we're living like the rest of the world, then we can't do what God calls us to do to the full extent that He calls us to do. So I'd ask you tonight, please stand and get a song ready. Maybe tonight you ain't got that relationship with God that I'm talking about. Maybe you ain't got a you're not saved. Maybe you don't have that relationship that I'm talking about, where you can always go to Him for, and He'll always give you the joy in your salvation, or He'll always be able to be there to protect you or to hold you. You can fix that tonight. You can come to all you got to do is ask God and tell God, like, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. Lord, I know that You sent Your Son to die on the cross and that He rose 3 days later. I believe in all these things, Lord. Lord, would You please forgive me of my sins and save me? That's all you have to do. Or maybe tonight you're here and you are saved, but you ain't been living the life that you're supposed to be living. You're not setting the example that you're supposed to be setting, and you have these unresolved sins in your life to where you keep on messing up. Or you have this one sin in your life that every time the devil throws it at you, you just fall. Tonight you can come to God and you can ask God for forgiveness, and you can make a vow to God tonight and say, Lord, I'm done. I'm done with this sin. I'm ready to start following You. I'm ready to start following You fully in the way that You have intended it. All you have to do is be willing to do what God calls you to do, and He will use you.
Amen.
And you'll be a much happier and joyful person than you've ever been as long as you stay in His will. So if you would, I'm going to pray. And if you would, please come. Dear Lord, I want to thank You for this day, Lord. I want to thank You for all that You do, Lord. I pray that You just touch the hearts of the people here tonight. Lord, I pray that You just use this message to touch all the ones here, Lord. Lord, I pray that You just keep us safe. In Jesus' name, amen.